I hope you all had a good break last week for the Thanksgiving holiday and recess. Welcome back to the public lecture series on the Wisconsin Idea Past and Present. The lecture series, as you know, is part of a new course that is being taught for the first time this fall under the auspices of the Department of Sociology at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. My name, as I think you probably, most of you know by now, is Chad Allen Goldberg. I'm a professor in the sociology department, and I have the honor to serve as the instructor for the course this semester. The Wisconsin Idea has always been about more than training students for the workforce. It meant, as Adlai Stevenson once put it, a faith in the application of intelligence and reason to the problems of society, the aspiration to light the way of Wisconsin citizens and government with the best torches of knowledge and understanding that their university can provide. Accordingly, this lecture series and the course with which it is associated aim to bring students, staff, and faculty in the UW system into a broad conversation with the citizens of the state about how the knowledge produced at the University of Wisconsin has benefited the public in the past and can continue to do so today. I encourage you to participate actively through our course website, www.wiskidea.com, and our Facebook page. If you are live tweeting this or subsequent lectures, please use the hashtag WiskIdea. The Sociology Department is offering this course with limited resources from our academic and our supplies and expenses budget. If you would like to contribute to this project to allow us to offer real-time broadcasts or otherwise improve our offerings this semester or in the future, please consider making a contribution to the Department of Sociology Annual Fund. You can do so through the course website. We are fortunate to continue our series tonight with a lecture by Mr. Aaron Bird Baer entitled Notes from the Ethnic Cleansing Zone, The Wisconsin Idea, Imperialist Nostalgia, and the Remaking of a Shared Future. Like all of our speakers, he is graciously donating his time and expertise free of charge out of a commitment to public service. A member of the Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara Nation, Aaron Bird Baer received his Educational Leadership Policy and Analysis Master's degree from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and previously coordinated American Indian Student Academic Services, a unit on the Madison campus supporting Native American students. He is currently interim director and interim assistant dean for the School of Education's Student Diversity Programs. Mr. Bird Baer's office oversees five academic programs that serve pre-college, undergraduate, and graduate students. It partners extensively with other state and campus institutions to provide resources for educators to teach students the history, culture, and tribal sovereignty of Wisconsin's 12 American Indian nations. Mr. Bird Baer also serves as the second American Indian Curriculum Services Coordinator, supporting the School of Education's integration of American Indian Studies content into teacher education programs. The American Indian Curriculum Services Office is designed to provide faculty, staff, and students in the School of Education with information on Wisconsin's American Indian history, culture, and tribal sovereignty. The office was originally created by Wisconsin Act 31, passed in 1991, which emerged from the recommendation of the 1984 Ad Hoc Commission on Racism, which convened to address the racism and ignorance demonstrated towards American Indians over treaty hunting and fishing rights. Act 31 charges the state of Wisconsin with creating a curriculum for grades 4 through 12 on American Indian treaty rights. It includes mandates for school programming to give students an understanding of different value systems, cultures, and human relations. Through Act 31, schools are required to teach American Indian studies at least three times throughout a student's K through 12 career and to maintain instructional materials which appropriately reflect diverse cultures. The Act's greatest impact on programs at the University of Wisconsin is that each teacher seeking a license from the state must have instruction in American Indian history, culture, and tribal sovereignty. Mr. Bird Baer has also served in the advisory group for documentary filmmaker Finn Ryan's production of short videos focusing upon contemporary American Indian communities entitled theways.org and accompanied by sets of resources, maps, and pedagogical strategies. This set of videos showcases the diversity of the state's Indian communities. It has become a celebrated pedagogical resource used by Native American educators, scholars, and community members. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Aaron Bird Baer.
Sovereignty, sovereignty, sovereignty. I sound like the amazing Ojibwe nations in the 1908 hearings back in the day, as they were trying to really advocate for something that was important to them. So notes from the ethnic cleansing zone is something I've always wanted to do as like a blog. I'm not from the Western Great Lakes. My ancestors are from the Central Plains. We in the United States call them the Northern Plains, but Canadians call them the Central Plains, right? So a little perspective. And so it's been very interesting for me as a person to live on this side of the Mississippi River versus the other side of the Mississippi River, because we are then within the 1830 Indian Removal Act, or what I term the ethnic cleansing zone, where we're going to try to force all First Nations inhabitants from east of the Mississippi to the west of the Mississippi. So I always said, like, you know, day 6,083 in the ethnic cleansing zone, I ate a Twinkie. So it's been very fascinating to see how institutions like the University of Wisconsin-Madison reconcile its complex history with Native Americans. And so tonight, I've assigned a couple readings for the course, and these readings are just trying to examine the context under which Native Americans functioned when the Wisconsin idea becomes named and codified as we kind of know it today. And so the Fighting Bob Natives newspapers and Fighting Bob article is really trying to showcase how Native Americans were being dismissed as they advocated for treaty rights, sovereignty, and their own land. And everybody else was focusing on these kind of concepts of assimilation, allotment, corruption, corporate abuse, abuses within the reservation system. And so here we are 100 years ago, Native Americans are really advocating fundamentally for tribal sovereignty as an important kind of aspect of their way of being, and it's not really being heard. And today we're kind of seeing that same argument play out in North Dakota, the Dakota Access Pipeline. Whenever you're in the way of commerce, forces, the big forces, right? Whenever you're in the way of commerce, you know, the fight gets really ugly really fast. And we're seeing that out in North Dakota, where we haven't seen protesters and people gathering in civil ways being targeted with water cannons and sound devices and grenades of all sorts. So it's just powerful to see that here the same fight for sovereignty, land use, treaty rights that's still playing itself out, you know, 105 years later, 106 years later. So that was that article. And the other article, Real Indian Songs, also really showcases, here it was again 102 years ago, you know, Native 104 years ago, that Native Americans were really trying to think, well, how do we contribute to Native American society? And what kind of ways do we enrich the greater American public with our ways of being and our languages? At the same time, they're trying to advocate for citizenship, equal rights, franchise. And they're really trying to find their place in the world and find their political voice as Native peoples. It's important to remember in the Society of American Indians convening here at UW-Madison in 1914, Native Americans were not yet United States citizens. So it's amazing to think about it, but my grandfather, born in 1908, was not a U.S. citizen. Was he a foreign national? Oh, was he? So it's really interesting for us as political beings, Native Americans, being a citizen of my own Mandan, Hadatsa, and Arikara Nation, we think of ourselves as political minorities and not necessarily racial minorities. But race being this form of control that's been introduced to the continent, we fall into these racial categories and constructs that are used as forms of control. So we still think of ourselves as members of functioning governments and citizens that fulfill the criteria for being within that jurisdiction of that government. But we still have to contend with this kind of new set of laws that have been placed on top of our laws and ways of being for some time. So the Wisconsin idea, you know, how does it function when whites pretty much view Native Americans in a kind of a sense of their eventual demise? They're not necessarily deserving of sympathy 100 years ago. And how are we going to contend with them as sophisticated peoples living in complex worlds when we view them in very simplified terms and stereotypical ways? And so 100 years ago, Native Americans are really wrestling with understanding how simplistically they're viewed, and they're trying to find ways to have political voice to showcase their needs and interest in development as nations and peoples 100 years ago. So I love these two articles because they really kind of set the stage for what's kind of happening in Native Americans 100 years ago and how we become these really powerful and sophisticated modern nations within the United States. So there's 567 Native American nations today in the United States. And we are really fortunate to have three of the most powerful American Indian nations here in Wisconsin. And that's just kind of political power. Because the joke is there's two important things in politics. The first is money, and I forgot the other thing. So, you know, we're having these great political actors now really functioning in the ways that government often functions. It's lobbying, it's all sorts of kind of partnerships. But we also have these amazing political actors in the North, that we have these world-renowned conservationists who have been able to stave off those forces, that incredible corporate power of extractive mineral mining. And that comes with a huge fight. And so it's been astounding to see the power of the Native nations of the North and these Native nations of the South and how they're creating spaces for their tribal citizenry today. So Wisconsin remains just an incredibly amazing state to kind of understand First Nations and where we're going as peoples and nations today. So I just wanted to kind of introduce that, where that idea notes from the ethnic cleansing zone and kind of the idea of the readings that we were kind of looking at today. And then boom, right? Picnic Point, all fluffy, all happy, how we think of Picnic Point. But if we went back in time 100 years ago, Picnic Point looks a little different. That it really becomes emblematic of the 99% physical and social transformation of the space we're sitting in tonight. That just a scant 160 years ago, there were only four non-natives living what is now Dane County. A couple traders, somebody had some sort of general store. So we had this pretty much a 99% indigenous body living here. And they lived in an oak savanna. And so it looked a lot different than the urban forest that we've kind of cultivated today in the space of the Four Lakes. But if we just went back in time a little bit, we had to kind of reconceptualize this space as something fundamentally, physically, ecologically, and demographically different than it is now. So Wisconsin idea? I believe that's some sort of Miami term that was two French guys who couldn't read each other's handwriting, went from Wisconsin to Wisconsin. And so even the name Wisconsin is quintessentially American. It's kind of gibberish. It's kind of made up. So it's kind of funny when I think of the Wisconsin idea, I'm like, you know, this kind of weird term that was misspelled and something, and now we just, that's the name. That's what we accept, right? And Americans are very good at making up things. See Valentine's Day, you know what I'm saying? The greatest corporate holiday ever known. So it's just who we are as a new nation, that we have to kind of manufacture things, and we have to rename things. We have to create senses of ourselves in them. And so the Wisconsin idea, whenever I think of that title even, I think of, wow, they're just going to accept this kind of whatever. I guess that's how it's going to go. So it's just an amazing kind of note. And so this is the Historical Society's page on how Wisconsin becomes a name. And kind of what it refers to is this mass kind of glaciation period and these amazing rivers that used to cut through Wisconsin when this glacier is melting and the river running through this red place and this kind of earth that's here. So we can kind of see the naming of where it kind of comes from of these older indigenous languages, and then they're kind of mistranslated or misspelled over time, and that's how we have our state's name today. So when you say the Wisconsin idea, from a First Nations perspective, we're going, that's a little strange. And then I put this on the bottom as a reminder for myself that I'm really famous for giving a landscape tour of campus. So, you know, I kind of interrogate the colonial landscape. So I go around and we kind of tug at these kind of monuments that we have that define the culture that exists for us now as an American society and the new ways we're creating traditions for ourselves as Americans. But when I gave a bunch of French faculty visiting, who are engineering faculty, this tour, they were like, it's so strange here. And the story we've been told is like this fully formed city just emerged from a fog. It's like suddenly, boom, Wisconsin's here. Madison's here. You know, it's like out of nowhere. And so the joke said, Aaron, we have this joke. We're going to tell you because you'll like this joke. And I said, what's the difference between the United States and a cup of yogurt? If you leave the yogurt alone for a long period of time, it will grow a culture. Right? So remember, the French are our friends. War of 1812, I think they saved us, right? So they're teasing us, right? We're a new culture. We're a new nation. We're kind of making stuff up as we need to. But that was just their kind of tugging at us a little bit. So for most of us, we come to this continent from this way, right? Maybe we're in a steamer in California. I don't know. We think of your ancestors and how they engaged this particular continent. Most we have history facing west, and the narratives of how we tell the story of this place are always about going west. But what if you're me? What if my ancestors, they came from somewhere else, right? Presumably coastal migration, some sort of boat migration. We're not even sure about that yet. We're still trying to pin down how humans populated this hemisphere all that time ago. But we're always my ancestors from the smiley face, right? My more recent ancestors out in the Central Plains. But, you know, and what if you saw the world this way? You know, those rascally Chinese invented the compass some 2,000 years ago. Central Europeans and Western Europeans adopt the compass about 700 years ago. So even our orientation to place and time is just so radically changed in the last 1,000 years for everyone. And I think the people who lived in the Western Great Lakes before the Americans arrived view this place fundamentally differently than we view it. We can kind of get a sense in that all the Ho-Chunk lodges, that every doorway to the Ho-Chunk Lodge faced east toward the sun. So it was just an incredibly orienting kind of component of their society and their way of being. So I just remind us these, you know, our orientations to things matter, and how we kind of think of ourselves in this world, this north-south kind of positioning is really new. And it's not something that has always been the way we understood this place. So, and if we saw the Ojibwe language, what used to be the language of commerce of the Great Lakes. So here we once again got the solar ecliptic representation, and we can see the place names in the Ojibwe language. And so if you lived here in Dajope in Four Lakes, we probably would have been polyglots. People in the Netherlands have shown us, yes, you can speak five languages. You're probably going to need to be successful. And so if you're a resident of the Western Great Lakes, you probably needed to know a couple languages. You need to know your own language, the language of commerce, the lingua franca of Ojibwe, and maybe you knew the space in this way too. So we're really fortunate today, right? Here we are in the ethnic cleansing zone, and we have 12 First Nations, three language groups. So we just have incredibly rich tribal diversity in the sense of the different Native nations, languages, and ways of being that we find in the Western Great Lakes today. Not everybody is originally from this spot. We have a couple arrivals from the East Coast, the New York Indians, who are now the Oneida Nation, the Brotherton Nation, and the Stockbridge Munsee Band of Mohican Nation. We have the long-term residents of Menominee who've been here for just an inordinate amount of time, just from when humans first arrived here in the Western Great Lakes. The Ho-Chunk and the Potawatomi. So just an amazing array of tribal nations and cultures and ways of being. And we're really excited that people like the Ho-Chunk Nation, the Ojibwe Nation, still have they have a base of linguistic first language speakers that they are trying to capture and renew their languages as we speak. So that's exciting developments today. So me, I'm famous for the little tour that could, right? I mentioned it, you'll see them giving it right here. And then it kind of grows into giving freshman convocation, welcoming our new students, talking to families when they come onto campus. I'm like, and why is this guy from the Central Plains talking about the Western Great Lakes again? But in developing a tour, here's the actual handouts I use, right? I have to hold them up because we have no markers on campus that really describe the First Nations and their place and way of being here. So we had to make a set of things we go around, like, okay, if we look at this lake, this is actually the site of an 8,000-year-old village, and we have to reimagine humans doing stuff here. Right? So I just kind of remind us that, you know, we have all these wonderful colonial monuments that describe aspects of our culture, but when it comes to First Nations, we don't have any. And so we have to kind of design tools that allow us to interrogate the colonial landscape a little bit to pull back that veneer to help us see the full human story of this space. So you just got a lot of different kind of diagrams that we use. So I just wanted to bring those out. And the reason my first year tour has had such strong legs all these years is that it's really advancing the learning goals we have for new students. Being a diverse member of community, taking different perspectives, working across difference. I mean, all these are vital skills that we need to thrive in today's world. And when we just kind of advance an 1848 forward narrative, we're kind of dismissing this deep human story of this space, and we're really actually saying that the only thing important are European American and American intellectual social achievements, and that diversity really is truly parsley on the plate. And I think we as an institution recognize that if we don't fundamentally acknowledge the full human story of this space, then we're going to undermine some of the learning goals we have for our newest community members. And so we kind of recognize what's valuable in examining the 12,000-year human story of this space. And so these are just some of the learning goals we've articulated as campus community members. And I kind of talk about imperialist nostalgia a little bit. And it's just this kind of sense of like, wow, man, I really wish these people had kept to their ways and not really taking full responsibility for, in some way, shape, or form, forcibly altering those ways of being, right? So we kind of see that all the time when it comes to Native Americans, and that we're often used as kind of like, oh, I hope you're proud of being Native American. I hope you continue to speak your language. You have no idea the amount of crazy inquiries I get walking around in today's society about, you know, our kind of sense of who Native Americans are, our cultural ways of being, just our general curiosity. And that a lot of people don't fundamentally understand the powerful forces that reshape Native Americans. And so this kind of, it just kind of gives a sense of pureness or innocence, and that maybe we haven't done this dramatic change of physical, social, demographic change in this space. And why I kind of say that a little bit, we have this great sign next to my building between North Hall and Education Building called The American Character. And it kind of describes this, the frontier thesis of Frederick Jackson Turner, kind of how the self-reliance and rugged individualism, and the quote is like the, quote, hard experience of colonizing the West, unquote. Right, that's on that sign. Like, hard for who? Probably everybody involved, right? Probably everybody involved. But it just kind of sense of this, you know, individual, rugged individualism that Americans have as a sense of identity that really comes, Frederick Jackson Turner kind of defines in his really amazing articles in the 1890s when he becomes chair of the history program here at UW-Madison. But at the same time, I always say it's a lot easier to settle somewhere that's been settled for thousands of years before you've arrived. And that's usually what's not accounted for, is that people have done a lot of work in shaping the environment to be so easily inhabited by Americans as they arrive. And that's the story, right? So if we just focus on that 1848 Ford, if we make a timeline that's 100 feet long, 1848 Ford is in fact the last 1.4% of that story. And that we're ignoring 98.6% of the human story of the space we're sitting in today by only focusing on the kind of intellectual and social achievements of European Americans or Americans in the space. So we used to have a burr oak tree, it says 1700. It used to be on Observatory Hill. It got cut down a couple years ago. And I can't use the pointer. But it's this little line right here. So we can kind of see, you know, we had this great living being that used to be among us, and it was our oldest living alumni, I used to joke. But even that, it doesn't really stretch that timeline too far. And so I just, our tour and the way we kind of examine our landscape is just really important to acknowledge that 98.6% somehow. And maybe we don't fully understand it, but we at least need to acknowledge it. And we need to acknowledge the Native nations who've been here for so long. So once again, that first year learning goals, right? Before I went to grad school, it was really hard to explain the benefits of this tour, other than everybody really wanting it for their classes. And the teachers really like it because it's like cracking the egg. You know, I get to crack the egg and the teachers get to scramble it up. And the tour had a really powerful impact on and having students fundamentally think about this space differently. But when we think of actually the learning goals we have for students and the amount of cognitive and social and intellectual development that actually happens in the first 2 years of college, that's how we realize, okay, we really need to have these tours in some of the big first-year courses we have for students, the learning seminars, the learning communities. And that's where this tour has really been robust, and that we often give about 75 to 100 tours a year now. And we do it in small groups because it's the only way you can really have discussions or kind of just digest this material that we're discussing about this place. So it just kind of reminds us that there's a lot to be gained, and there's a reason why we started focusing with the first-year convocation and having these new messages about Native nations, that 98.6% of the story we might have ignored previously or maybe not given as much attention as we could have. I like the moral and ethical reasoning is fixed in college. It's hard to change that afterward for whatever reason, right? So just, you know, the kind of development that happens in college is super important for us to consider. And courses like this are trying to do that, I think. So I always tell students, this is a slide whenever I go into teacher education, that we should not be afraid to tell our history. It is a little messy, no doubt about it, but we seem to tell other messy parts pretty well. So when it comes to American Indian history, we shouldn't shy too much away from telling it just as it is. And the reason we can have so much confidence in discussing it, and the reason I'm kind of playful tonight, I also use humor as a tool, because if you don't break up the mood a little bit, when you kind of think about some of these parts of American Indian history, we can get into a lot of navel-gazing or anger or shame or guilt or all these interesting emotions, right? And I don't want us to dwell there. I need us to think about the material. And so I'm going to often use jokes to kind of keep us in the moment. So here we have shared cultural production, and we know that kind of the French and the American Indian nations of the Western Great Lakes were really engaged in a profound sense of cultural production. We see the lasting legacy of the French in our mispronunciations of Prairie du Chien and Lake Butte-Amour, Lac de Flambeau, Le Coudere, right? So we have this deep, deep sense of the French presence here. But when the Americans arrive, we call it the erosion of accommodation, and there's violence and or violence. When the Americans are not going to intermarry with the First Nations of the Western Great Lakes, and there's going to be a pretty rapid dispossession of Native American land base in the Western Great Lakes, there's going to be an amazing contest for the Western Great Lakes itself. So we go through this period from the 1820s until the 1900s of the incredible contest for the space with the arriving Americans, who don't come here until after the War of 1812. Americans have really no idea what's here, where we're sitting now, until they start sending survey crews until the 1820s into this region. So we have this kind of erosion of accommodation. But here we are back again, you know, 100 and something years later, and that we're engaged in cultural production with Native Americans. And that's such an exciting space to be. In fact, you know, we're in an unprecedented era of Indian and non-Indian cooperation that the history of the United States has never known right now. And since we're in this incredibly spectacular era of shared cultural production, it's why we can speak with so much confidence about our history. And in fact, in modeling the ability to remake shared cultural production, we're modeling those exact skills we're asking our newest community members to begin to build in themselves. Working across difference, seeing different perspectives, right? These are things that we ourselves have done as an institution. And we'll see that in a little bit. So I say we can fearlessly talk about our history. It gets a little messy, but I think everybody's history is a little messy. We look at Central Europe and the last 300 years, they have a messy history based on a lot of seemingly religious and kind of political differences that have kind of reason why so many people decided to come to this hemisphere. So during the tours, whenever we stop at any building, because every building will show you something about federal Indian policy, is you simply have to ask, okay, Wisconsin Idea, 1912. At least that's when it's named in that way. Well, what's happening with Native Americans? So if you ask at any point in time, we can look at the major kind of areas of federal Indian policy or American Indian history, and we're going to see the Wisconsin Idea is created during removal and reservation and coercive assimilation. And in our articles, we kind of saw that people are really concerned about these children in these Catholic schools and in these assimilation boarding schools. And people are really concerned about the abuse and corporate abuse they're having on reservation life. That, you know, there's these coupon vouchers for timber and the incredible exploitive nature of that economic arrangement. So in, you know, coercive assimilation, removal and reservation, that's the kind of period we're in when the Wisconsin Idea is kind of coming into its own genesis. And it kind of reflects this to some degree. So it just kind of a reminder that anytime any kind of building is put up or any kind of policy is enacted into law, we always have to ask ourselves, well, what is happening with Native Americans? What's that perspective that they have for that particular event and time and place? And so despite maybe that progressive era not fully including Native Americans, is what Patty Lowe's article was kind of trying to remind us. We kind of think about the shared future that we're making together now, and that we're really excited about the shared cultural production that I mentioned earlier, and that it's just, we always will wonder, like, what would have happened if we'd combined our knowledge bases together instead of the attempt to eradicate our knowledge bases that were developed in this hemisphere for over millennia? What kind of creative innovation might have happened if we had partnered our knowledge bases together instead of been in this great contest for the space, both ideologically and physically, for the land itself? So that's just one of the things we kind of ask ourselves, and I think we're going to be excited to see the Wisconsin Idea in the next 100 years about what does that innovation really hold for us. So free soil, right? That's that concept, that idea that we're going to clear the inhabitants of this land for free labor, right? We're gonna have this incredible creation of this new economic model in this space because there's a whole lot of natural resources here. And the timber of the north, the mines of the south. So the whole idea of free soil is that, okay, we gotta clear out the people so we can really get at this resource itself. And that Native Americans are given the kind of idea of assimilate or face extinction. Those are your two choices. So when we look at the Society of American Indians in that article, Real Indian Songs, they're really trying to contend with, well, what does survival really look for us? If they're saying assimilate or die, you know, is citizenship the right pathway forward? Is acculturation, not necessarily assimilation, the right pathway forward? How do we gain political voice and try to find our space within the society, given these alternatives that our ancestors had to contend with in the late 1800s and early 1900s? So it's just a kind of a fundamental paradigm that's operating when this kind of Wisconsin idea is coming into play. Right, and we kind of see a little bit in the history of the university. So Reuben Thwaites writes this history, and it kind of reminds us of the first territorial land grant. We have 72 parcels of land which are bequested to the institution to use that land for revenue, to develop a kind of a bank account for itself. And then importantly, we kind of see in the history, you can choose sections out of any public lands within the territory to which Indian title has been or may be extinguished. So even in the histories of this institution, the University of Wisconsin, we kind of get a sense of this free soil notion and this play for land that's happening that's going to sustain this very institution. So it just reminds us that land grants, there's a downside. If you're a Native American, we always say that, where do you get that land? Do you grow it on the land tree? Do you stretch the land underneath your feet? So there's going to be a lot of dispossession in the Western Great Lakes. And I think one of the earlier slides, I wasn't able to look at it, but it kind of mentioned that there are no reservations in our Big Ten partners, and there's no reservations in Illinois, there's no reservations in Indiana, there's no reservations in Ohio, there's no reservations in Pennsylvania, there's no reservations in New Jersey, there's no reservations in Maryland. We're talking complete ethnic cleansing, right? We're complete dispossession. So we can kind of see, you know, land grants in the Big Ten are going to come at an enormous cost for some. So, and we see it reflected a little bit in our initial Wisconsin territorial seal. If we speak Latin, which I do not, we'll kind of see civilization succeeds barbarism. That was our 1838 Wisconsin territorial seal, right? And then it kind of goes into this forward, right? So we get a sense of kind of the idea and the concept of who's going to be developed in this space and what ideas are going to be developed in this space. We can see that succession from the first territorial seal that's put forward and to our contemporary seal today as a state. And we have Indians kind of leaving on steamships on the top diagram and farmers coming in. And we can kind of see this kind of change of economic commerce and mode of being here. And then, you know, when we look at the Wisconsin idea itself, when we have this kind of forward with a quote, and it says, the hard-hearted men who broke the prairie, hewed the forests, made the roads and bridges, and built little homes in the wilderness. And we're already starting to see this kind of projection of, like, well, there was nobody here. We're innocent. We developed something that was undeveloped. And we just kind of always say the little homes in the wilderness. There's a very popular series called Little House on the Prairie. And my joke is it should have been titled Little House on the Ethnically Cleansed Prairie. It would have been more appropriate. And then, you know, it's asserting that, you know, a great university and all the good that is with us. So it's important to remember kind of the values and ideals that are being forwarded for some, but they're definitely at the expense of others in some way. So it just kind of reminds us about the kind of preamble that's in the Wisconsin idea itself. And it kind of still has that assertion that maybe there wasn't anybody here and that we made something great where nothing was. And they thought that way because it was a really fantastic oak savanna and prairie, right? Just an incredible ecological jewel that had been crafted by humans for millennia. And that the oak savanna is a human manifestation through millennia of controlled burning and the ways of being that people farmed in this region and made their hunting grounds. And so this great oak savanna in the south and these prairies were created over millennia through human intervention. And then you have that incredible northern block of woods of the powerful north that's going to become that timber industry of Wisconsin. And then we have these wonderful resources on campus, these oak trees that are reminders of that oak savanna. They're between 250 to 350 years old, which means the first half of their lives are simply in and among the Ho-Chunk Nation, right? That these trees have witnessed two distinct societies around them. And without a doubt, that's one of the greatest joys of fourth graders is to hug these trees and think about the incredible worlds they witness around them. So it's just a really fun thing to recognize that we still have vestiges of this different ecosystem that used to be here, of these living beings that are with us. And then maybe they thought they were in the wilderness. Maybe they thought nobody was here, right? Because we just gone through an epic population collapse. scholars are still trying to contend with. Is it genocide, or do we always have to have a qualifier? Cultural genocide? Or is it just genocide? Right. So we go from 6 million people. It's actually 248 is a generous number. The other number is 237,000 Native Americans are alive in 1900 in the United States. So myself and every other Native American person you meet is a descendant of one of these Native American survivors for the colonization of the United of this hemisphere. And disease is obviously the largest kind of impacting factor. But we have warfare and colonization and other practices. In 1960, we're up to about 500,000 people. And then, boom, we just take off. And it's not because we're just all having like 100 kids, right? This is not how it's happening. We see the kind of progress of us as a society where suddenly everybody's going, I'm 164 Chippewa, baby. Everybody's suddenly claiming their Native American ancestry on these censuses, right? We're not quite as progressive to say I'm 164th African American yet, right? We're not claiming that. But we are claiming Native American ancestry more than ever, which is a very interesting phenomenon, at least from our perspective as Native Americans, of why so many people are kind of opening up to this kind of sense of connection to the hemisphere or their mixed race family history. But we can kind of see this period. So the Wisconsin idea is born when American Indians are at our lowest of lows, and that we're in this incredible, brutal kind of cauldron of assimilation, that between those vertical yellow lines are when Native American languages and cultures are criminalized by U.S. law, and that we've already created internment camps for Native Americans, which are called reservations. We have a youth incarceration system, which are called the boarding schools. My grandparents were all forcibly, or four of my grandparents were forcibly removed from their families and put into off-reservation boarding schools. My Dene grandfather was taken when he was 7 and not returned for 11 years. So he went into the boarding school system, Nawud Kinlachine, and came out Robert Harvey. Right, a complete cultural and kind of remaking of a person. So that's the kind of cauldron that people are in. So I could get a sense of the Wisconsin idea and the preambles and the things we're seeing in it. I was just kind of thinking, well, these are a vanishing people. They are going to go away because we're doing our best to make them go away. Right? We're actively trying to disassemble their nations, languages, and ways of being. And then we have that ethnic cleansing on a continental scale, right? That just precedes the kind of creation of Wisconsin. We can kind of see this map of this great depository from east of the Mississippi to west of the Mississippi into what we call Indian Territory, which becomes Oklahoma. So we can get a sense of the incredible forces that are reshaping this continent that are happening right before the creation of the university and the territory that eventually becomes Wisconsin. And then we're engaging in it here, right? So here's the local story. So here's the 40-year effort to ethnically cleanse the Ho-Chunk Nation from their home. But the Ho-Chunk are just too savvy. They're too smart. They're just too tough. They lawyer up. They get some lobbyists. And they, enact their own return. I mean, they thwart through a guerrilla war effort led by Roaring Thunder, also known as Dandy, an amazing resistance to being removed from their ancestral home. So we can see they're pushed across the river immediately. That's the Indian Removal Act. And then they're shuttled up north, and that's not a good place to be. So there's a couple shuttlings in between. We see these dotted lines of always a return. There's always a return, that they're just not going to be removed from their place of being. So just an amazing story of resilience and resistance in the Ho-Chunk Nation's ability to remain in this space at great cost. And those dark red dots that we see in the state, those are the homesteads of the Ho-Chunk Nation, because they exploit a provision in the Homestead Act to repurchase land, like citizenship, farming, sure. They have no intent of doing that, but they're going to say they are. And they purchase homesteads in the state, and they create they're able to remain in this space. And it's so creative of a legal ploy that it results in a new law called the Indian Homestead Act, that we have to enact a new law based on the brilliance of their strategy to remain in this place. So it just reminds us that, we're not, despite Wisconsin's progressivism and its sense of who it is as a state and as a society, we're fully participating in the federal expectation of removing indigenous inhabitants from this region, east of the Mississippi to west of Mississippi, taking people out of the ethnic cleansing zone. And then, but what's exciting, right? Shared histories. Here is Representative Garvin, UW-Madison alumnus, speaking with the leadership of University of Wisconsin Stout about their shared history. So we talk about this kind of remaking of shared cultural production, that it's important for us to understand our shared history first. We're not defined by it, but we're definitely influenced by it. And we need to kind of understand the roles that have kind of shaped who the modern Indian nations are, their communities and peoples, and the ancestors of all of us who've spent some time here in the Western Great Lakes. So it's just super exciting to see this new unprecedented era of cooperation where we have institutional leadership actively seeking out and partnering with the tribal governments of the Native Nations of Wisconsin. So here is Representative Garvin speaking with the leadership of UW Stout. And that was a tweet from October 11th, so that's brand new. And then when we think about our own leadership here in the ethnic cleansing zone, and that 40-year struggle, or 42-year struggle, and we see it kind of manifested in a couple campus landmarks that we can visit. The class of 1888 markers right by Social Sciences, and a talk about the Black Hawk Wars. It talks about 25 years after they graduate, they give us a gift to campus, and as part of that gift is a monument. And they chose to describe the Indian Wars of the Great Lakes, the Black Hawk War. So it was really amazing. It must have left a powerful imprint on them somehow. That's the message they chose to leave us, that there was a contest for this space. And it's something important for us as a class to remember. And the class arch, on the Camp Randall Arch, it talks about the 25th Wisconsin Regiment participating in the Dakota War, that great uprising just across the river that resulted in the largest mass execution in U.S. history. President Lincoln was president during the hanging of the Dakota 38. So 38 men were hung all simultaneously in Mankato, Minnesota as the outcome of the Dakota War. So we can kind of see the Indian Wars and this kind of ethnic cleansing period captured on our own campus in a couple places. And then this reminds us that during that ethnic cleansing period, here's the university leadership on the left, Lathrop, Barnard, Sterling, Chadbourne, Twombly, and Bascom, all complicit some way, shape, or form of during this ethnic cleansing period. And then we see the presidency of the U.S. state. And obviously Jackson starts the Indian removal process with the Indian Removal Act, and it continues all the way through Johnson after Lincoln. So when we think of Lincoln, people always think of him as this, you know, great person who was able to hold together a fragile republic, somebody who had to deal with the original sin of our democracy, was slavery, as some people call it. And so, but when we Native Americans think of Lincoln, we think of him as someone totally different, right? We think of him as somebody committed to the ethnic cleansing of Wisconsin, that he's a leader during ethnic cleansing of Wisconsin. And he's a participant as Lieutenant Lincoln in the Black Hawk Wars. So we think of him very differently. Whenever we give Ho-Chunk communities tours, they sometimes have some harsh words for President Lincoln, right? Because move the earth might mean something else to the Ho-Chunk Nation or to the Potawatomi Nation than it does to us, right? It might have a very different connotation when you think about what he represents in terms of the contest for the space itself. And then if we looked at kind of a 2010 census map, and it's kind of hard to see, but it shows where Native Americans are at in the United States today. So the darker the green, the more Native Americans in that county is how that map is read. And the top map is just American Indian alone. On the census, you didn't necessarily check anything else. And on the bottom map is American Indian and one other race. So if you said you're American Indian and African American, American Indian and white, you would kind of see the multiracial Native America on the bottom, and then American Indian just alone on the top. Now, Native Americans are not the greatest participants in the census. We've been tracked for a long time, and we're always suspect of when the federal government wants to know where we're at, right? So it just reminds, but that's the kind of data point that we have about where Native Americans are in the United States. And then, you know, we go back to Wisconsin Idea Text. Theodore Roosevelt is the guy giving the shout out to the book, and he's arguably has just a tremendous amount of animosity for Native Americans as a president, right? He believes in the complete pulverization of the tribal mass, is what he believes in, assimilation and dispossession of Native Americans. And his quote in 1886 is like, they're not, you know, the only good Indian isn't necessarily a dead Indian, but I wouldn't trust that 1 out of 10, right? And then, you know, the most vicious cowboy has more moral principle than the average Indian. So when you look at the kind of cloaking around the Wisconsin idea itself, maybe these aren't the best things to choose, right? Maybe these aren't the best ideas to kind of represent this incredibly powerful idea, which has so much value still today. But from an American's perspective, you're starting to put some layers on it that are making us concerned, right? And then the soil, in the kind of chapter, and there's kind of talking about the soil, Wisconsin is fundamentally a German state. I think the Rathskeller next door kind of reminds us of that a little bit. The great Teutonic branches, and they brought with them their high ideals. And so it just kind of reminds us about, you know, the settler state that Wisconsin's becoming and who's populating this settler state. But my question to you is, like, is that fundamentally German? Really? It looks a little more diverse than German to me. But so it just kind of reminds us about kind of the language that's within it is, once again, told from that colonial view, that 1848 Ford, that last 1.4%. We're not necessarily going all the way back and including others in the kind of Wisconsin idea when it's conceived, and there's all sorts of reasons why. And then if we really thought about the Ho-Chunk Nation, right, we thought about people settling here, and the Ho-Chunk have spent a lot of time settling this place. Other villages of Old Turtle, Four Lakes, Broken Arm are now the cities of Middleton, Madison, and Monona today. Right? So we've kind of built our own civic life on top of the Ho-Chunk village life. And it's just a kind of an amazing testament for us to think about how we're going to share that space today. And the Madison Common Council just passed Ho-Chunk Day. So the Ho-Chunk Nation Day is now officially recognized by the city government. And so we're seeing this incredible co-production happening again, which is very exciting. And we had Indigenous Peoples Day for the last decade, and now there's a Ho-Chunk Day in November, the same day that they do it. So just a really powerful kind of that shared cultural production and re-acknowledging how long humans have been here and the many different peoples that have been here. And our students were kind of recognizing it, right? So in the midst of the kind of Wisconsin idea and the creation of the Wisconsin idea, they were doing this great pipe of peace ceremony. Real Indian songs kind of got it. Native Americans are trying to use dance and song as a way of advancing their needs, and then suddenly people start running with it. They start running with it, and maybe they can do something you don't necessarily like. And our student body had really ran with it. They have elaborate costumes they're wearing, and if we look at this picture on the upper left, they're wearing wigs. The pipe of peace, every graduating class would attach a ribbon. It happened the Friday night before commencement. They'd enact this really elaborate Native American pageant for almost 50 years. And it becomes a defining actual motif of the Wisconsin Union. The Union seal is actually the pipe of peace itself. And if you look hard at every door on the Union, the old brass doors, you'll see the shield of Wisconsin Union where the pipe is included within it. And so if you go look real hard at pictures of the metal brasswork, if you go look in the center, you'll see the symbol of the Union and the pipe of peace is there. And so it comes from this incredible kind of elaborate activity. We call that imperialist nostalgia, right? We're saying, look at these cultural ways of being these peoples used to have. At the same time, Native American children are all incarcerated in boarding schools in this moment of time. So we're trying to eradicate Native American language and culture. At the same time, white students are pretending to be Native American, right, and enacting their cultures. So just that kind of the article, Real Indian Songs, and the dilemma of trying to find political voice and using song and dance to do that. But the kind of unexpected outcomes that come with it in cultural appropriation today. So it just kind of reminds us that, you know, our own campus community was deep within it. And the Society of American Indians visit in 1914, when they themselves enacted a pretty elaborate pageant, kind of showcasing reservation life and the challenges of dealing with Indian agents and their reservations. They also had a pageant. They didn't really want to do it, but they did it. And it seems to have influenced our own pipe of peace activities and made them more elaborate. So it's just that kind of song and dance and culture as mechanisms, political voice. But in showcasing that and trying to showcase it in a way that's palatable to non-Indian audiences, sometimes you create things that you don't expect. So just kind of recognition of our own students doing this type of activity as they're trying to understand who Native Americans were at that time and kind of recognizing them as the vanishing peoples, remembering them as they used to be, and not thinking of them as the kind of a cultural dynamic peoples that are continue forward, but more stagnant peoples with a culture that is something of the past. And then we see the fourth annual Society of American Indians. That's Lathrop Hall, so our dance hall. So there's the incredible group of Native American leadership here, and Angel Decorah, and William Kershaw from the Menominee Nation, and Henry Rocloud from the Ho-Chunk Nation. All these famous Native American leaders of Wisconsin, Indian nations are there. And they're trying to contend with do we go with citizenship? Do we go with equal rights? How do we get there? What does the future hold for us as Native people since we're not U.S. citizens yet and we're trying to contend with the U.S. government who's occupied our land bases? So what are we going to do? What's our way forward? So it's amazing that this is really the start of the relationship, that Wisconsin idea concept of how do I use our expertise to improve your needs as Native peoples? But it's not quite worked out as we'd like. It's viewed as extractive. It's not necessarily seen as reciprocal in any way. There's a lot of problems that happen initially with it. And it's also that Native Americans are viewed as like one rung down in the evolutionary ladder. When I was looking at kind of the debates of students when they're looking at Darwin's Origin of Species, Darwin had us as either another species entirely or a subspecies, right? So that's your science of the day. Do you respect other or sub? Maybe not, right? So, you know, early research is kind of viewing us in maybe inferior ways and maybe not partnering as much as in a sincere way as we would like. So there are still challenges, but there was research happening, and that the Society of American Indians Conference being hosted at UW-Madison is an amazing point in time where the institution starts thinking about the needs of Native Americans. And so it starts, you know, 100 and something years, 102 years ago, this relationship. And it's scattershot, right? It's by no means coherent. But faculty are all entrepreneurs, and they do and follow their own research agendas. And maybe those research agendas intersect with Native American cultures and ways of being sometimes. So just kind of a reminder that 102 years ago, we had this powerful convening in Lathrop Hall. And it kind of really fundamentally illuminates the Wisconsin idea in action as it's beginning to connect with Native American nations. And then it leads us to today, that in March 2015 was the first time in the history of the university that the chancellor hosted the tribal presidents, the tribal governments of Wisconsin. Took us a while, but we got there, right? That shared cultural production. It's super exciting. It's super hopeful. We can kind of see some goals that are coming out of this ongoing development. So realistic, practical action plans that unite tribal and university resources. So we're thinking of, what does a Wisconsin idea look like for the next 100 years? We've seen a little bit of an incoherent and inconsistent kind of organization in the past, but what kind of strategic plans might we make with tribal nations today? And that's this exciting development that's just started at the institution since we've just hosted tribal presidents for the first time. Here was that gathering. We can see the tribal presidents themselves in March. We can see kind of the kind of presentations and hanging out with Chancellor Blank and trying to, what are those relationships going to become? What do they look like? What's really the substance of those relationships and the plans that we might create together? And here's the charge memo. I'm on there. We have to develop a strategic plan for the next 3 years about how we're going to figure out the initial steps toward partnering with Native nations as we go forward. So it's just kind of letting us know senior leadership at the institution is committed to seeing this through. They put some really wonderful people to task to figure out how we're going to set the stage for the next 100 years of collaboration going forward. But we don't have to worry about three right now, right? Just three, just little bits at a time. And then, you know, I'm on a committee, and I'm like, wow, that's really amazing. We got an Office of Federal Relations. We got an Office of State Relations. Those are only three of the four governments in the state that I know of. I believe there's tribal governments here, too, right? So it's an amazing kind of challenge for the Wisconsin idea to fully actualize itself if it's your Office of University Relations doesn't fundamentally acknowledge tribal governments by having a director of tribal relations when you have a director of state relations and you have a director of federal relations. So tribal governments exist above state governments but below the federal government, right? So just kind of a reminder that we have a little missing piece of the puzzle, at least from it seems a logical place one would insert how one could broker relationships with Native nations, considering that that's how we do it as an organizational institution. So we can see campus and visitor relations, community relations, corporate relations, federal relations, state relations, and hopefully in the next 100 years we'll see tribal relations, right? We'll see that kind of recognition and thinking of how do we forward the Wisconsin idea within Native nations. UW Extension has been doing amazing work for a long time, but when they broke out of the Wisconsin, right, when they broke out of the University of Wisconsin and became the University of Wisconsin-Madison, you know, we lost a lot of that outreach component we had as an institution. And that this incredible heroic figure, Brian Gochee, is revered in the community he serves. When I was on the listening groups that we went out to Native Nations this summer to hear their concerns, much like we had the 1909 hearings and 1908 hearings, in the state to hear the concerns of tribal nations. They were saying the same thing, you know, tribal governments, environmental concerns. But we had this guy named Brian Gochee. He's just really helpful. And some of the Native nations like, well, we want a Brian Gochee. So this person and the role he fills working with UW Extension is extraordinarily valued by Native nations today. So, you know, our project includes UW Extension, UW-Madison, and UW colleges in thinking about strategic partnerships with Native nations going forward. And UW Extension continues to model what outreach and effective outreach can really be and the deep relationships you can make with Native American nations. And then, you know, we have helped along the way when the Ho-Chunk wanted to kind of amend and change their constitution. we were able to provide that kind of expertise as an institution. The UW Law School had a lot of contribution to helping the Ho-Chunk deal with their constitution as they wanted to make some changes in the early 90s. And then here we see as a complex and sophisticated universe of the Ho-Chunk, that's the tribal court. I'm sorry, the traditional court. So the Ho-Chunk have another body of governance called the traditional court, which are composed of the clan leaders within the Ho-Chunk Nation. And that court is conducted in the Ho-Chunk language. And it is a part of how they make decisions as a Native nation today. So they have a branch of government that's a little different than we have. We don't really have a necessary commensurate kind of component to our government that they have. But we did, as a university, contribute to how they're going to amend their constitution. So when you think of the Wisconsin Idea in Action, I kind of think of its intersections with tribal governance, and this is just a really clear example of us in the Wisconsin Idea Native Nations today. We have an articulation agreement with the Menominee Nation. This is this year, 2016. So I used to give the freshman convocation, but I'm not from here, right? Maybe we should have one of their voices do it. Now that I've earned your trust, maybe we can really help say, okay, this is a better way to go. This is more authentic. This is the voice of the Great Lakes themselves. And our student body should learn from these cultures and these peoples, and not from surrogates like myself, who, although we understand learning and I'm deeply connected to undergraduates, that we really need to have the Native Nations at the table. And it's a high-stakes event, right? 6,000 people. Stay on message. You know, I can understand the concerns of an institution, but I'm so thankful they had the courage to see it through. And David Greendeer, Representative Greendeer, shared such a powerful message of Notch Kapi and caring for one another as Ho-Chunk peoples and the ways of being that they have. So here's that shared cultural production happening again. That's so exciting, that offers us so much optimism and opportunity here in the 21st century. Ho-Chunk Nation Plaza, that just opened up. Camp Randall, presidential delegation with Barry, celebrating kind of this connection point. Dejo President's Hall features a few thousand years of human story within it, and the incredible late Woodland Society and effigy mounds that define our campus in so many ways. So we can kind of see these great cultural partnerships happening. And so it's something we can point to when you tell the students, this is working across difference. This is learning to see other perspectives. This was hard to do. Trying to come to consensus on what we name it, what's inside of it. It almost broke down like three times because the decision making of the Ho-Chunk Nation does not follow the timeline of UW Housing. Right? But UW Housing was courageous enough to see it through, and they violated all the timelines that they normally do. Because what's more important, getting it right or adhering to a timeline? That's really arbitrary. And I understand why you want to open with signage in a certain time period, but it's not going to end the world to open with a placeholder sign. So it was called Four Lakes Hall when it first, or it was like Lakeshore Residence Hall or something, I can't remember. We had to have placeholder names when it opened because it wasn't done being decided upon. And I'm thankful that Housing had the courage to realize their policies could flex a little more than they thought. And we have Dejo President Hall, something that everybody's very proud of today, and the Ho-Chunk return to and give presentations in. So that's just what I want to show you, a very hopeful future, considering the beginnings of the Wisconsin Idea at a time when maybe we weren't thinking of Native Americans as equals, but Native Americans had so much agency and so much energy in creating the space for their own civil rights, the continuance of their cultures despite the incredible attempt to detribalize Native nations and families. And so here we are again in this great period of renewal. You're looking at the first generation of recovery and renewal who wasn't forced into some non-Native American kind of way of being. That my grandparents were removed from their families, my parents had to fight for their own civil rights as college students, and that here I am allowed to be, you know, as Ada Deer calls me, a yuppie Indian. Or when she's teasing me even harder, hey, there's Aaron, he's a co-parent. She's teasing. Teasing's part of the culture, right? But here we get to be the people we want to be. And that's an exciting place to be in the 21st century. And so the Wisconsin Idea is alive and well, and we're seeing this amazing innovation that's happening in partnership with Native American nations today. And so I just wanted to add that to your discussion in reminding ourselves that the institution wasn't necessarily totally benign when it began, but it's definitely opened its doors wide open and is really trying to form these honest and sincere partnerships with Native American nations today. And then I leave you with that photo, which is Milton Baines, the first known Native American student at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and we have his application in the UW archives. So it's exciting to see kind of when Native American students began entering this institution. But we didn't have our first Native American student graduate from the university until 1946. So it took a little leap before Native Americans really started participating in the institution. So thank you so much, and I'm excited to have your questions.